Hi, welcome to the initial lecture of JSH 214, class on Tomer Devorah, a very important sefer by the incredible Rabbi Moshe Cordovero. This is a recent edition of the book, of course, entirely in Hebrew. This course will have all of the course materials in translation as well, together with my commentary. And I hope you find it interesting. The purpose of today's class is just to give you a very brief introduction to who the author, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, was, and a little bit about the content of the book. And then finally, we'll talk a little bit about how to complete this course and receive an excellent grade for all of your efforts. I'm going to experiment a little bit with providing these online lectures and see what works best, whether I do it with a live class or whether I do it privately like this. So, let's begin right away. Okay, there's a PowerPoint here on Blackboard. All the PowerPoints are also available, so you can follow along. Rabbi Moshe Cordovero was born in 1522 and died in 1570. He was one of the most important figures in the so-called Tzvat circle, an uncommonly creative and an original group of rabbis who really had an explosion, a flourishing of Jewish literary activity and intellectual activity in the 16th century in Tzfat. And we'll get to that in just a second. He's famous for many works. Tomer Devorah, or the Palm Tree of Devorah, is certainly his most famous work, although among scholars he is exceptionally well regarded for his Pardes Rimonim, which is the Orchard of Pomegranates, which is a work of Kabbalah, and the shorter version of it, the abridged version called Or Ne'erav, as well as his commentary on the Zohar and other things. But we're going to focus in this class on Tomer Devorah, which is a work of surpassing genius that I think is really a life-changing work of Jewish thought. So, a little bit to his background. Excuse me while I take a drink. This is my Perry the Platypus water bottle that my wife recently bought for me. He comes from Spain originally. The name Cordovero certainly implies that he originally came from the Cordoba region, although technically speaking he was Portuguese, of Portuguese extraction. It's possible that his family came from Cordoba, Spain, and fled with the exiles of 1492 when they were expelled from Spain into Portugal. The Portuguese expulsion was equally dramatic in 1497, Rabbi Cordovero's family made their way ultimately to Tzfat in Israel. Whenever he wrote his name himself, we have several autograph manuscripts, he did not use the spelling Cordovero. He referred to himself as Cordoero, which is the Portuguese transliteration of his name. Furthermore, he also was associated with the Portuguese community in Tzfat, so it's most likely that he regarded himself as of Portuguese extraction. Nevertheless, the Spanish version of his name, Cordovero, has become much more popular, and so we'll use that in our discourse as well. He's known also popularly as the Ramak, which is an acronym of his name, Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, a Hebrew acronym. The expulsion from Spain was like a lightning bolt in the Jewish world of the 15th century. It came completely unexpected, even to the greatest thinkers and leaders of the day, such as Don Yitzchak Arbarvanel. If you visit my website, jewishhistorylectures.org, I've got a whole hour on his life and his activity during the expulsion. And it was cataclysmic. It was announced by to a select circle of individuals, including Abravanel, at the beginning of 1492, and then made public in March, and the Jews were given 3 months to leave the country. All Jews had to be gone from Spain. It was Judenrein as of the end of July, a date which, coincidentally, July 31st was Tisha B'Av of that year, the terrible date, the national Jewish bad luck day, as it were, that commemorates the destruction of the temples, the expulsion from Spain, the decimation of the Warsaw Ghetto, and the Holocaust. It's a day that reverberates with negativity for Jews. At any rate, many of the Jews who fled Spain at that time, you can't really see the PowerPoint that well on this video, but if you download it from Blackboard, you'll see it better. Many of them went to Northern Europe, to more liberal areas like the Netherlands. Spinoza, of course, and others ended up there. Many of them went to North Africa, to Italy, and the Cordoveros made their way all the way out to Israel, where they settled in the Galil region in Sfat. And that's where Rabbi Moshe Cordovero was born, most likely to first-generation refugees from the Spanish expulsion, possibly second generation. We simply don't know with precision. At any rate, a little bit about this phenomenal Tzfat circle that exploded in the 16th century with Jewish originality and literary achievements. The members of the Tzfat circle included figures such as Rabbi Yosef Karo, the author of the Code of Jewish Law, the Shulchan Aruch, and Rav Yosef Karo was the Rebbe, the principal teacher of Rabbi Moshe Cordovero in Halacha. You can't imagine a greater teacher in Halacha than the author of the Code of Jewish Law himself. The Ramak actually married the sister of his teacher in Kabbalah, Rabbi Shlomo Alkabetz, known principally for his authorship of the Shabbos song Lecha Dodi. And so he was very close to his Kabbalistic mentor, who was also his brother-in-law. And the two of them would go on these strange kind of self-imposed exiles. They called them gerushin, or divorces, where he and his teacher, and then later Rabbi Cordovero alone, would go out and wander around the Galilean countryside and would somehow divine the location of the graves of tzaddikim, and there on those spots they would say special prayers or perform special rituals that was designed to, in a theurgic manner, create a positive benefit to the universe. A rather fascinating kind of activity. Finally, another extremely important member of the Tzfat circle was a figure no less than Rav Yitzchak Luria, known as the Arizal, one of the most famous Kabbalists who ever lived, who actually came from Egypt to Tzfat specifically to study under Rabbi Moshe Cordovero. So the Ramak actually has the unique distinction of being the student of the greatest halachic expert of the era and being the teacher of the greatest Kabbalist of the era. That is, there are some distinctions between Cordoveran Kabbalah and Lurianic Kabbalah, the Kabbalah of the Arizal, and perhaps we'll get into that in a few moments. But at any rate, this was a period of phenomenal activity of the Jews. These rabbis really created such a tremendous change that is still reverberating to this day in the Jewish world. One last fascinating side note. There was another member of the Tzfat circle, an individual named Rav Yaakov Beirav, who argued that the collected intellectual power of the rabbis in Tzfat was of such a tremendous stature that he felt that they could actually renew the smicha ritual which had been lost after the exile of the Jews from Israel. Smicha is ordination in English. Literally what it means is the laying on of hands, and that refers to when Moses was made the first rabbi, so to speak, Moshe Rabbeinu, Moshe our teacher, Moshe our rabbi, and then he laid his hands on the head of Yehoshua, Joshua, and thereby transfer to him his learning and his authority. So Joshua became, as it were, the second rabbi. Yehoshua then went in turn and gave smicha to his students and their students, and so on and so forth. However, with the political tribulations and the social upheaval, the demographic losses associated with the first and second exiles of the Jews, the chain of smicha was lost. Rav Yaakov Beirav in Sfat, however, in the 16th century, felt that given the concentrated nature of these great Jews, they could together agree to resurrect the smicha. They would collectively agree on giving smicha to one individual, and that person would then have the same authority and power that the original people who received smicha in turn all the way back to Moshe Rabbeinu had held. So in fact, they got this together, and Rav Yaakov Beirav received smicha from the other great rabbis, and then he in turn delivered it to those who gave him smicha. And although it kind of petered out after a couple generations, there was quite a bit of enthusiasm generated in the Tzfat circle for the resurrection of smicha. It's long been opined that the Ramak himself received smicha in this manner. That's most probably not true. He was really quite young at the time, and many of the original documents speak against this. If you're interested in the specific details of this, I would highly recommend that you read Dr. Zohar Raviv's excellent study, biography, an intellectual biography of Rabbi Moshe Cordovero, which is available through Amazon and several other outlets. At any rate, this gives you a sense, though, of the greatness of the Tzfat circle, and Rabbi Moshe Cordovero was right at the heart of it during this time. Going to the next slide, I hope. Where is the next slide? Aha, I hate when technology kind of slows me down. Let me try pushing this button. There we go. Did I go the right direction? I hope I did. Okay, so here's a slide that shows the grave of the Ramak in Sfat. He died quite young, as many of the great Kabbalists, unfortunately, pass away very young. But what was fascinating about the Ramak's Kabbalah was that he was the first systematic analyst of Kabbalah. First of all, what is Kabbalah? Basically, Kabbalah refers to the mystical teachings of Judaism, which certainly go back to the earliest written sources of this faith, referring to things like the nature of the afterlife, the nature of the soul, the nature of God, the means of creation, the way in which God's will is affected in the world, angels, demons, a whole host of things fall within the parameters of Jewish mystical thought. And the primary sources for it include the Bible itself, even more so the Midrash, and later the Mishnah and the Gemara. There are lots of discussions of these kinds of things throughout. It's sometimes referred to by language such as the Chochmat HaEmet, the wisdom of truth, the hidden wisdom, all kinds of things like this. And then there's several works which are exclusively directed to Kabbalistic content throughout the first millennium, and then a major work appears in the 13th century attributed to Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, who lived over 1,000 years earlier, and that is the Zohar, which was introduced to the world by Rabbi Moshe de Leon. In all of these works, however, there is no systematic, organized, thematic description of what is Kabbalah, what are the constituent elements of Kabbalistic thought, and so on, until the Ramak. The Ramak was the first thinker to take all of these documents, in particular the Zohar, to which he was a great devotee, and then organize them and say, well, okay, this is how you understand these ideas, and after you understand these ideas, then we can move on to these more complicated ideas, and so on and so forth. This was one of his first works, the Pardes Rimonim, the Orchard of Pomegranates, which was a major systematic analysis of Kabbalah, which was accepted virtually overnight by Jews around the world because of its clarity of thought, which was lacking in much of the arcane arcane and, well, I shouldn't say that it was lacking, but it was difficult to access in the arcane esoterica of the Kabbalah as a whole. So he published this Pardes Rimonim, and he engaged in a really quite a prolific series of works. Hey, Mr. Levin, how are you doing? I'm just recording a lecture right now. Yes, Tomer Dvor, do we have a student coming in? So they're coming in a little late. Okay. So this is kind of awkward because I've already started this lecture. What do I do now? Maybe I should pause and then I'll repeat this information and then and I'll come back and I'll finish this lecture. Okay, that's a good idea. Come on in, Mr. Lax. Come over here, and I need you to stand behind this camera and push the off button. Okay, there we go. This is awkward. You see the little button on the back? You just push it in.
This one.
Try it. Let's see what happens. Yeah, try it. What happened?
It